I thought I'd do a little tutorial on how to sound like Freddie Mercury. I'm not a vocal coach, and I've never taken voice lessons, so I don't really speak the language of the technical stuff behind how to sing. I just kind of learned from imitating other singers. I'm going to do my best here to maybe, if I can't communicate to you how to sound like Freddie, because it has a lot to do with genetics, thank you, Mom and Dad, I can at least communicate to you how to have a starting point to sing Queen's music. I was speaking with an actor a couple years ago who wanted to know how to sound like Freddie Mercury because he was a bit of an imitator himself. And so he was like, dude, how do you do it? How do you sound like Freddie Mercury? And I know he was a little bit disappointed, probably. I could see on his face when I said, I don't know, man. I just do it. I don't force it. I just naturally sound like Freddie, and no matter what I'm singing, especially when I'm singing rock, you know, people will always, without fail, tell me, hey, you know who you sound like? And by now I do, and it's always a compliment. Even to the point where now I sing with Queen's official tribute band, the Queen Extravaganza. I didn't have any magical explanation for him on how I do it. When I told him that, he started looking at me scrutinizingly, like he was examining a crime scene or something. Or then he said, yeah, I can tell in your jaw structure it's kind of the same as Freddie's, and your nose is shaped very similarly. You probably have the same sinus cavities and all those same resonances in your head. And I'm like, yeah, man, that's basically it. A lot of it has to do with genetics, but I can try to communicate to you sort of the spirit of how to sing like Freddie. So the way I want to do that is take one song, Bohemian Rhapsody, in which Freddie explores a vast range of his vocal stylings. But before you sing Queen, you gotta be in touch with the lyrics, you gotta be in touch with your emotions. Freddie was always emotionally interacting with the music, whether it be live, whether it be in the studio. You know, live, he would lose his voice a lot because he had so much passion to give to these songs that after a couple of nights in a row, you know, he would start to sound hoarse. That has a lot to do with singing Queen. Now, a good vocal coach will tell you not to do that, but you've got to really give everything you got to be convincing at it. So be in touch with the lyrics, understand what you're singing. You know, you got to get emotionally involved with that. Now, once we've laid that foundation, let's get into the actual tones of Freddie Mercury's voice. Now, the first one is the intro after the piano starts in Bohemian Rhapsody, the very first verse. Let's hear that.
Mama just killed a man.
So that's what I call his soft, vulnerable, whispery tone. It actually reminds me a lot of George Michael, honestly. If you go, Mama just killed a man, there's almost like that throaty George Michael thing in there. I'm a big fan of George Michael, so it's kind of, I liken that to him.
Put a gun against his head, I will be your father figure, I have had enough of...
It's Freddie's George. Freddie came before George, so let's do it's George's Freddie, if that helps at all. The second tone is Freddie's kind of go-to rock voice. Now, his rock voice changed. Earlier, it was very pointed and thin and yet powerful, kind of like an angry violin, very gritty. And let's hear that. He's giving so much passion that the pitch of the note sort of becomes secondary, especially in his vibrato. He's sort of all over the place. I think that's what gives it the mojo.
So you think you can love me and leave me to die? Oh, baby.
You're more concerned with the delivery of the line than really hitting that note. It just kind of puts you in mind of someone who's unleashed and giving himself into the moment. So that's the tone where you've really got to be careful when you're singing Queen, because if you do that too much, if you don't listen to your throat, if your throat starts to hurt, you got to stop that. Change your voice, because you could do some real damage to your voice. But when singing rock is a big part of what you do, that's sort of the name of the game. It cuts through the mix in a rock song, especially when you're competing with Brian May's guitars cranked up to 10 and Roger Taylor's drums blasting. Back in the days where they didn't have in-ear monitors, Freddie had to really, not necessarily sing loud, but point his tone in a way that it would poke through the mix. I think that's a big reason why those singers back then had very sharp sounding vocals. And I think of Robert Plant and lots of other singers from the 70s. They had the because that just, that sharp tone just blasts through even guitars and loud bass and drums. But always support with the diaphragm, people. Don't sing from your neck and your throat. You got to push the air out to get enough support. I do not want you to hurt your voice. That's the number one thing. I'm just trying to communicate to you what I do by feel. Now, we're going to skip the choir section in the middle because that is just mock opera. And I think anyone who can sing can pull off something fairly convincing. My favorite moment in Bohemian Rhapsody is the very last time Freddie sings Mama in the second verse. Let's hear that. When you're talking to your mom and you know that you're breaking her heart over what you've done, you can't help but get emotional about that. It sounds like he's crying, Mama! He's like, he can barely hold on to the note because his emotion, his sadness is getting the best of him. And Freddie was a great communicator of emotion. You know that the guy's going through probably the hardest time of their lives and they can barely stand it just from that one way that he sings the word mama. Now, like I said, Freddie had a lot more tones than that. The way his rock voice changed in the 80s, the older he got, the more macho and deep his rock tone became. I think of songs like The Show Must Go On. He's kind of gotten rid of all the uncertainty in his voice and all the frailty. It's a very powerful, strong, this is who I am. Show must go on! Instead of show must go on! You know, it's fuller, there's more chest involved. Even the way he sang Bohemian Rhapsody in Wembley was much different than the way he used to in the 70s. Mama just killed a man, put a gun against his head, instead of put a gun against his head. One way to sort of sound like Freddie is to imagine that you're a little bit congested, like, Mama, ooh, didn't mean to make you cry. If I'm not back again this time tomorrow, carry on, carry on. It's almost like he didn't really breathe through his nose. And if you watch stuff like the Live Aid performance, when I think Freddie was suffering from a really bad cold that day while he was giving one of the performances of his life, instead of doing, life had just begun. You know, when you're tired, when you're sick, you kind of lose that top end of your voice. And so he went, life had just begun, but now I've kind of thrown it all away. A lot more macho and less of that effeminate thing he did in the early 70s, which was cool. And then I guess he decided that wasn't cool anymore in the 80s and sort of became this different persona. There's really a journey in Freddie's voice across his career. He started sort of as this ballerina feminine thing going on, and then it sort of morphed into a more macho, manly, deep in the chest, it's a kind of magic. Now, you wouldn't hear that tone early in the 70s. You would hear, it's a kind of magic. Yeah, the multifaceted vocal colors of Freddie Mercury. There you have it. I try to cover it as much as I can. Hope you enjoyed this video, and I'll see you soon.